So thank you very much. And I will be discussing about abdominal wall anatomy, and I bring greetings from Institute of Minimal Access Metabolic and Bariatric Surgery and Institute of Robotic Surgery, Sir Gangaram Hospital, and from Bhatia Global Hospital and Endosurgery Institute. Now, basically, the presentation outline is that as we go from outside to inside, that means skin, superficial fascia, deep fascia, muscles, transversalis fascia, extra peritoneal fat, and parietal peritoneum. So I would be classifying my presentation in such a way that we are going to discuss about the facial anatomy, the muscular anatomy, vascular anatomy, and neural anatomy. Now, discussing about the facial anatomy, all of us know that above the level of umbilicus and below the level of umbilicus, the layers are different. The above the level of umbilicus, the single layers, that means the fused camper and scarpa fascia are there. And below the level of the umbilicus, we have fatty outer layer, that is the camper fascia, and membranous inner layer, and that is a camper scarpa fascia. So we have these two layers. That means most of the times, frankly speaking, in various workshops, when we demonstrate ventral hernia repair, and I ask people that which one is superficial and which one is deeper, I would say that 50% of the times, most of the posteriors, they feel that scarpa is superficial and camper is deep. So our thinking is loud and clear that we should remember that camper is fatty layer, scarpa is membranous layer. And the camper layer is continuous inferiorly with the superficial thigh fascia, whereas the scarpa fascia fuses inferiorly with the fascia lata of thigh. And posteriorly, it continues as pollis fascia of perineum. Now, in this small photograph, though it appears to be a line diagram, which is quite some disturbance is coming. So, it is quite clear that we have dissected the abdominal wall muscle. So, this is the level of the subcostal margin, and these are the rectus muscle. And one can see the intersections of the rectus abdominis muscle. And this is starting from this is the Z-fistulum, Z-fistulum process, and it is going up to the pubic bone, pubic symphysis. And then we will be discussing about the muscular layers also, the external oblique, internal oblique, transverse abdominis, and fascia transversalis. But honestly, all of us have been taught in our undergraduate days also that what is the kind of direction of the muscles, for example, external oblique, then internal oblique, and then transversus abdominis. So we should always remember that this is the way our muscles are arranged. And then basic thoughts are that from God has created a symmetric kind of anatomy, that from the both these sides, the linea alba is being formed, and this linea alba is from xiphoid to the pubic symphysis, and then it has got the facial layers. So the external oblique is covering and forming the rectus sheath, and the transversus abdominis is behind, and that again forms the posterior rectus sheath. But the internal oblique is dividing and having two leaves. So one is going anteriorly to the rectus muscle and one is going posteriorly to the rectus muscle and fusing with the posterior rectus sheath. So we have to be very, very sure that we should know that the rectus sheath, what is the anatomy of rectus sheath, and then posterior rectus sheath is going to finish off at the level just below the umbilicus, and that will be the arcuate line. Many times, if I go and ask people that what is arcuate line, not many people remember that, that this is the line of Douglas. And the semilunar line is the Spiegelian line. I will go into slighter details later on also. But again, as surgeons, one should know that these are the muscles, the external oblique, internal oblique, transverse abdominis, rectus abdominis, and pyramidal malleus. Many times, I am always surprised that we do not know the location of the pyramidalis also. I think that is very, very important that maybe in 20% of the cases, pyramidalis can be absent. Now, if this was the situation which we were seeing from the anterior aspect, and once we go to the posterior aspect, and once day after tomorrow, we will be having a discussion about the ventral hernias. So at that time, we will definitely talk about the lumbar hernias also. So these lumbar hernias are through the lumbar triangles. And one should always remember that the lumbar triangles are formed by two aspects, that bone, one bone forms the boundary and two muscles are there. The superior lumbar triangle, the inferior lumbar triangle. This is the superior lumbar triangle, and the superior lumbar triangle has three marches or boundaries. This is the 12th rib. One should always remember, many times I have seen that people get confused that is it the 12th rib or it is the iliac crest. So in the superior one, in superior lumbar triangle, it is the 12th rib, and quadratus lumborum, which is lateral margin, and the internal oblique, it is the medial border of the superior lumbar triangle. Whereas the inferior lumbar triangle, again, it has one bone and two muscles. What is the bone? That is the iliac crest, and the bone, the muscles are laterally, it is the external oblique fibers, and medially it is the latissimus dorsi. So if the herniation is occurring through these layers, then it will be the lumbar hernias. Again, as Dr. B.B. Mishra has told me right at the beginning, that repetition penetrates the dullest of minds. That has been my slogan right from 93-94 onwards. When I started doing the laparoscopic inguinal hernia and ventral hernia repair, our thinking is that we should carry on repeating and reciting. Then only it will get into our gyri and sulci of our brain, and that will get cemented. Again, in this photograph, one can see that the arcuate line, you can appreciate that the on one side we see the intersections of the rectus abdominis, but on other side, that means the patient's left side, you can appreciate that the rectus muscle has been taken off, and this is the posterior rectus sheath, which is just finishing at the arcuate line. And this arcuate line is called as line of Douglas. And the lateral, that means at the lateral border of the rectus abdominis, the external oblique, internal oblique, transverse abdominis, so they are dividing into sheath form, and this forms a line which is called as a Spiegelian line. And I will go into the details after some time. And you can appreciate the direction of the muscle fibers in this diagram of the lateral abdominal wall. I don't think so that one has to go into details. Now, in this situation also, if we take a sectional view, you can appreciate that at one level, at this level, if it is dividing into two, that means the internal oblique is dividing into two, the anterior rectus sheath and the posterior rectus sheath, the vascular anatomy, I will come to this point later on, one can appreciate that the vessels and the nerves will be present posterior to the rectus muscle rather than anterior to the rectus muscle. So vessels will be present here in the on the posterior aspect of rectus abdominis, and then you can appreciate that the transversus abdominis muscle also has an extension. It does not finish off at this level. For example, the external oblique is finishing at this level and is forming the sheath. The internal oblique is forming the two sheaths, which are making the anterior rectus sheath and the posterior rectus sheath. But the transversus abdominis is going quite medially and then forming the rectus sheath, or it is amalgamating with the posterior rectus sheath. So what is the importance here? The applied anatomy of importance is that when we are developing the TAR plane, transversus abdominis release plane, then we should be very, very careful. We should be knowing this, that the transversus abdominis is going more medial than the internal oblique and the external oblique. This is a very, very important observation, very small observation, and this is there above the level of arcuate line. Whereas, as we mentioned, that below the level of the arcuate line, one should not expect that we will have the posterior rectus sheath behind. All the three lamina or the sheaths will be anterior to the rectus abdominis. The posterior rectus sheath will not be there. Again, we can revise that the rectus sheath encloses rectus abdominis muscle, and lower down it is the pyramidalis. The anterior rami of lower six nerves and superior and inferior epigastric vessels and the lymph vessels. And one can appreciate that these vessels, are you able to see the superior epigastric vessels and the deep inferior epigastric vessels? So they are present posterior to the rectus muscle, and this is the level at which the rectus abdominis is nicely encased. I will definitely discuss about the vascular aspects later on, and again revising that the Spigel line and the Douglas line. Douglas line is arcuate line, Spigel line is this line from the ninth in subcostal region and from the costal cartilage to the pubic tubercle. If you draw a line from tip of the ninth costal cartilage to the pubic tubercle, that will be the linea semilunaris, that will be Spigelian line. And this is the arcuate line. Only thing is that this arcuate line, again and again, in the day after this presentation also, we will be talking about the posterior rectus sheath transition. So one has to know that the posterior rectus sheath transition will be at a variable level. Sometimes it is just more close to the umbilicus rather than more close to the pubic bone. And one can appreciate that it may be 1/3 or 2/3, but many times it can be half and half also. But mostly we have seen that it is 1/3 of below the umbilicus and 2/3 above the level of the pubic. That will be the arcuate line. Again, one can appreciate in a sagittal section that this is the rectus. I am again and again very, very cautious in telling this, that this is the sheath which is continuing. This is the internal oblique dividing into two, and transversus abdominis continuing. And one can appreciate that if we go below the level of arcuate line, all these condensations of the fibrofatty tissue are going anterior to the rectus abdominis muscle. As I mentioned, that arcuate line of Douglas, maybe it is in between the umbilicus and the pubic ramus, and this can be absent in 30% of the individuals. Means that it will not be so well formed in 30% of the individuals. Many times if the patient, we see that arcuate line and the posterior rectus sheath are beautifully made, and one can appreciate the junction. When we do, for example, ETEP, then we are able to see, once we make a scope at this position, that we subcostal region, and then we are seeing from above, and we are posterior to the rectus abdominis muscle, then we will be able to see that suddenly there is a dip. Hello? Are you getting these slides? So there will be, so there is a sudden dip of the condensation of the fibrofatty tissue. So above this level will be the posterior rectus sheath, and below will be the fascia transversalis. And this fascia transversalis, and behind this will be the peritoneum, the parietal peritoneum. So one should be very, very clear that when we are made, and that is the advantage. Now we are taking with E-tap. Means once we make our port at the subcostal region, whether we are going to do the bilateral inguinal hernia repair, TEP, or we are going to do the ventral hernia repair by E-tap method. So we have gone behind the rectus muscle. We are seeing the posterior rectus sheath. We are going, now you can appreciate in this also, that once we go down, that one will be able to see the arcuate line very clearly. And this is the level of the rectus abdominis. And this is the level in which, for example, if we go deep down, then it will be the cave of Retzius. And in this position, again and again, when we talk about the surgical anatomy of the posterior rectus sheath, we will see that we have to cross over from, for example, one side to another side. And this is the place. That means arcuate line has started from lateral, it is going medially, it is inserted onto the linea. This is the linea alba. So on the linea alba, it is inserted, and then if one has to cross over, then one should remain more peripheral rather than more central. If, for example, if I go deep into it, then I may injure the peritoneum, and that can become, I would say, challenging situation when we are going to do the TAR or we are going to the ETAP for ventral hernia repairs. So one has to be very, very careful that when we do the crossover, either inferiorly or superiorly. Superiorly, I will come to this point slightly later on. When we work on the level of the ligament, falciform ligament, then also we should be very, very clear that we see the posterior rectus sheath, and then we incise it and we see the other side muscle, so that we do not go deep into the layers and cause injury to the vessels or to the peritoneum. Now again, one can appreciate here that this is the level of the vessels which we were discussing. Means this is the level of the rectus abdominis. Can you appreciate that? So this is the rectus abdominis muscle. Below the rectus, that is posterior to the rectus abdominis, are the blood vessels. This is the blood vessels. And these blood vessels are, one, the inferior epigastric. They are coming from the inferior epigastric region, and they are coming from the superior epigastric region. And then they are having the anastomosis in between, and one has to be very, very careful when we are going in. And similarly, I would spend some time on the distribution of these vessels. This is, for example, this is the inferior epigastric vessels. This is the level of the arcuate line. And at the level of the arcuate line, the inferior epigastric vessels divides. And divides into, now comes the vascular anatomy. And in this, one would appreciate that there are variations. Variations of the division of the inferior epigastric vessels. All of us know, and I know your PG answered me last time also, that the inferior epigastric artery arises from the external iliac artery, and inferior epigastric vein drains into external iliac vein. On this situation, as I am showing the left side of the abdominal wall of the patient, so the inferior left inferior epigastric artery is arising from left external iliac artery and it is draining into corresponding vein. So as this is the arcuate line, and at the level of the arcuate line, the inferior epigastric vessels will divide and divide into two or three branches, or it can continue as one branch. And I will show you the percentages, whether it is 53%, 29% and so on and so forth. At this level, so there is a variation. It cannot be that everyone will have the continuity of the inferior epigastric vessel into one vessel, but there will be situations that it just at the arcuate line, it will be dividing into two branches, or it will be dividing into three branches. And these epigastric branches, they then ultimately will have the anastomosis with the superior epigastric artery. And this superior epigastric artery is coming from the internal thoracic artery. That also we know. And internal thoracic artery is a high pressure vessel. So if, for example, now again talking about some about the applied anatomy, that this is the level of the xiphoid, this is the level of the subcostal margin. If I am making a epigastric port just close to the xiphoid, and if I injure, for example, if my port goes directly at this spot, that means injure the superior epigastric artery or the and or the superior epigastric vein. The superior epigastric vein is draining into the subclavian vein, and again the pressure is there. So we can have lot of bleeding. Our thinking is that all entries and all exits must be shown. The camera person has to be trained in such a manner that when we are making any entry with the trocar, we should be able to see that we are not injuring the vessel, and if the vessel has been injured, then it should not carry on bleeding, and we come to know later on. So again and again, I always insist, even in, for example, Dr. Mishra, laparoscopic cholecystectomy, many times I have seen people making the this epigastric port quite away from the midline, or if it is too away, then it is fine. But if it is just close and injures these superior epigastric vessels, then the surgeon will think that he has done an excellent laparoscopic cholecystectomy, and he does not withdraw the cannula and the trocar under the region, and later on this bleeding vessel will carry on bleeding, and ultimately the patient can go into shock. My thinking is, again and again, first is prevention, that we should not cause any injury to the superior epigastric vessels here. And then even if we have injured, the camera person should be smart enough to detect that, and then at the time of removal of the cannula, we should make sure that we are not leaving the bleeder behind. God will never help the bleeder to stop. And according to us, as you remember, that I always say the surgeon is the best clotting factor. So one has to stop the bleeding there and then. Now this was about the superior epigastric, this was about the inferior epigastric. But there is a distribution of the vessels, and one can appreciate that these are vessels which are coming again from the external iliac vessels. That means the deep circumflex in arteries and in circumflex veins, and the subcostal arteries and the veins, they are also coming and they supply this zone of the abdominal wall. So one should try not to injure them also. And for that, we always insist and we always tell that once we have gone in with the scope, and we are for example in the peritoneal cavity, if it is a thin walled abdominal wall, then one can use this as a diaphanoscopy. What is diaphanoscopy? diaphonoscopy is that the camera person is lightening the scope light from within, and the surgeon is able to see onto the anterior abdominal wall, and he is able to see the inferior epigastric vessels and the superior epigastric vessels, or these vessels even laterally, and then one tries to avoid the injury to any of these high pressure vessels. Again and again, for my our younger postgraduates, first year, second year, third year, I would request you that please remember that internal thoracic artery, superior epigastric artery, external iliac artery, inferior epigastric artery, deep circumflex iliac artery, again external iliac artery. So they are high pressure vessels and they can lead on to challenging bleeding later on. And they have done lot of, I would say, MRI studies also. And then they have realized that the deep superior epigastric artery and the intercostal arteries also one can see in this distribution. And the, these are the some deep inferior epigastric vessels, and that these lateral ones are the deep circumflex iliac arteries. Again and again, the thoughts are that we should be avoiding any injury when we are making the ports into it. For example, now in this situation only, if I make an incision in the subcostal region here, and if I go behind the rectus abdominis, I pull the rectus abdominis behind and then go into it, and then we remain on the posterior rectus sheath, we will see these vessels, but we will avoid injuring them. But if we, by accident, if we injure them, then lot of bleeding can occur, and because it is only a limited space in ETAP, that will become challenging, and that can, I would put it this way, that can screw the operation also. So we should be very, very gentle, very, very careful. And Hooker had divided the zones of the anterior abdominal wall into three zones. And this is called as zone 1. You can appreciate that. This was the arcuate line. This is the semilunaris line. So the area between of the rectus abdominis or the mid-central abdomen is supplied by deep superior and deep inferior epigastric vessels, and this is called as zone 1. Whereas the zone 2 is the lower abdominal wall, and this is supplied by epigastric arcade, superficial inferior and superficial external pudendal and superficial circumflex iliac, which are coming from the external iliac. And the lateral, that means this is the zone 3, lateral region of the flank region is supplied by the musculophrenic, lower intercostal and lumbar vessels. So again and again, emphasis is that we should know the our anatomy very well, then only we will be able to avoid injury to these vessels, and we should be very clear that if, for example, again for simplification I would say that if I have made a entry into the umbilicus at the time of primary entry with the trocar, and then if I am making the secondary ports at the horizontal line of the umbilicus, this is the horizontal line of the umbilicus, then obviously the inferior epigastric vessels, if I am slightly lateral, then I will not injure that. If I am medial to the spigel line, then I will injure the inferior epigastric vessels. So our thinking is that in the back of our mind, we should remain horizontal, in the horizontal line of the umbilicus when we and when we are making the secondary 5mm port or 10mm port here. But if I go deep down, as we have seen the gynecologist, especially the gynecologist, once they make the entry into the pelvic region, if they are staying in midline, very good, no vessels are there. If they are staying lateral in this zone, not many vessels are there. But if they are in zone 2 and then they injure the inferior epigastric vessel, this inferior epigastric vessel has a high pressure, and if it retracts, then it can cause lot of oozing. So dictum is that when you are making these secondary reports, make it under vision. Under vision, as I mentioned, that all ports have to be shown by the camera person when they are being made and when the cannula is being taken off. And one can appreciate that one has to localize the position of the lateral ports or the secondary ports in such a manner that we do not cause any injury. Now, a few words about the deep inferior epigastric artery. As you were told that this is the deep inferior epigastric vessels artery, and this is of three types, type 1, type 2 and type 3. But basic thoughts are that the deep inferior epigastric artery divides approximately at the level of the arcuate line. And once it divides at the level of arcuate line, the type A, that means you can appreciate that if the type A is there, it is continuing as one vessel. One is able to see that it is continuing as one vessel in 29% of the cases. Whereas if it is dividing into two branches, then it is in approximately 57% of the cases, and rarely, that means 14% of the cases, it is dividing into three just after the arcuate line. So what is the importance? What is the applied anatomy of this? That when we are doing ETAP, when we are making the secondary ports, when we are doing the crossover, then also we should not injure the deep inferior epigastric artery. So, and we should know that there is a variation, and variation is that it can have two vessels, two branches, or it can have three branches, or it can have one branch. So again and again, answer is seeing is believing, that one should see that and then we should not injure that. That is most important. Again and again, these are the small tips and tricks of the surgery, that if we respect the tissues are going to respect us. So again, these are the rectus abdominis, and one can see the anastomosis of the vessels in this area. So one should be very, very careful that when we are working inside the peritoneal cavity, then we are not causing injury to these vessels. And again, one knows that there are the levels of the perforators also. These deep inferior epigastric vessels, they communicate with the superficial inferior epigastric vessels and through the perforators. And one can appreciate on MRI also that this is the level of the perforator, and they have marked it also. So one should try not to injure the perforators, because if we devascularize the rectus muscle at that very time, we may not know. And later on, yes, the hematoma formation or even the necrosis can occur. Or later on, the functional aspect of the muscle will also change. So thinking is that please pay lot of respect to the vessels. And now coming on to the venous drainage. In this also, as we mentioned, that the inferior epigastric veins, they drain into the external iliac vein, and the superior epigastric veins, they ultimately drain into the left subclavian vein. So thinking is that again, we should be careful, and plus I would request all my younger colleagues to know in this zone 3, the level of the lumbar vessels, because these lumbar vessels can, or the musculoskeletal musculocutaneous vessels, they can also bleed a lot. So one has to be very, very careful when we are making the secondary port. As I mentioned, when we do, for example, ETAP RS, this is the level of the umbilicus, this is the level of the arcuate line, and if I go in and make at the junction of the spigel line and the Douglas line, then the chances are that if I go slightly lateral, then I can injure the vessels, these lumbar branches also, and that can unnecessarily spoil our feet. Again, revising that veins of the anterior abdominal wall, if we are working above the level of the umbilicus, then they are draining into the lateral thoracic vein and into the axillary vein. Below the level of the umbilicus, in the superficial epigastric and great saphenous vein. And the para-umbilical vessels, you would remember the caput medusa, that these are at the level of umbilicus and they are going into the portal vein. And the deep veins, they follow the arteries. That means superficial epigastric, inferior epigastric, deep circumflex iliac artery, they follow the arteries and ultimately drain into internal thoracic and external iliac veins. Again and again, thinking is that we should not injure the arteries and veins. Similarly, the lymphatic drainage, the lymphatics above and below the umbilical level. Above level, it is going in, as we had seen in the venous drainage also, that it was going into the axillary vein. Similarly, one can always remember that above the level of the umbilicus, the lymphatics are draining into the axillary group of lymph nodes, that is the pectoral group of lymph nodes. And below the level of the umbilicus, they are draining into the superficial inguinal lymph nodes, as we saw that external iliac veins. And back above the level of the iliac crest, they are again going into the posterior axillary nodes, and whereas below the level of the iliac crest, they are draining into the superficial inguinal lymph nodes. And the deep lymphatic vessels, they are again following the vessels, arteries, that means the internal thoracic, external iliac and posterior vessels. Now coming on to the last aspect of the anatomy is the nervous supply. And as again and again I am mentioning that one has to be very, very careful, especially in the neurovascular bundle. One can appreciate that it will not be too much of a differentiation. For example, this is the level of the inferior epigastric vessels and this is the neurovascular bundle. One can appreciate the rectus abdominis. This is the posterior rectus sheath which is finishing off or which is there. So, if I cause an injury during the dissection or with the help of harmonic or the monopolar or bipolar, the injury to these neurovascular bundles, then the chances are that my muscle on that side, on the rectus abdominal side, will have either an anatomical challenge or the functional challenge later on. So thinking is that we should try our best, one, not to injure the inferior epigastric vessels, but definitely of paramount importance is not to injure the neurovascular bundle. And one would appreciate that these neurovascular bundles are ultimately responsible for abdominal wall functioning. And what is the difference of thoughts which has come in vogue recently is that initially when we were doing, for example, laparoscopic IPOM or IPOM Plus, then we were not much caring about the functional anatomy. But when we started doing these kind of surgeries in patients who were sportsmen or they had six abs and whatnot and they had hernia, then definitely that would jeopardize the function of the muscles. But lately, the advantage of abdominal wall reconstruction is that we are taking care of the functional anatomy of the anterior abdominal wall also. That means we are caring for the nerves, and as we mentioned, the lower six thoracic nerves, that means T7 to T12 are these nerves, and the anterior MI and the L1, that means iliohypogastric and ilioinguinal nerves are there. But basic thoughts are that these nerves are present in between the internal oblique and the transversus abdominis. You can appreciate here that this is the level of the external oblique, This is the internal oblique. This is the transverse abdominis. So the nerves are present in between the transverse abdominis and the internal oblique. Means, for example, as our anesthetist colleagues give a TAP block, TAPP block, then also they have to go from outside under the guidance of ultrasound. They have to cross from external oblique, internal oblique, then there is a click and one can go into the plane between the transversus abdominis and the internal oblique, and then instill the local anesthetic here, so that ultimately the area is having the local anesthetic effect and the nerves are affected. For example, if they go deep into the transverse abdominis and they remain either outside the peritoneum or go into the peritoneum, the effect will not be there. So thinking is that know thy anatomy well, know your position of the nerves very well, and when we are using the monopolar or bipolar, again and again, when we are dissecting in those planes, when we are doing, for example, when we are doing the TAR, then also one should be very, very careful that we are not going to injure the neurovascular bundle. In this diagram also, one can beautifully see that these are the level of the nerves in between the internal oblique and the transversus abdominis. And then it is going into the rectus muscle and supplying that. So that one has to be very, very careful. And then you can see the lateral cutaneous nerves also, as we mentioned, at the level of perforators. So these nerves will be there. So we should try not to injure these nerves. And one can appreciate that there are lot of nerves which are coming from one side to another side, and then they are meeting, or they are just coming close to the linea alba. On the linea alba, not much neural supply is there. So one has to, if for example one has to make the secondary ports, then one can make at the linea alba, and then will not cause these neural injuries. But there will be many situations when we have to make the lateral port entry. So we have to be careful about the neural system also. And in this, again, we are seeing that this is the level of the arcuate, and these are the level of the nerves which are seen. So one has to be very, very careful when we are doing the dissection. And again, one can see both on the anterior aspect, the lateral aspect, and the posterior aspect. And again and again, many times I have requested, I have seen younger colleagues, when they are putting in the tacks, for example, when they are doing ventral hernia repair, and if we give lot of pressure from outside, then one can definitely injure the iliohypogastric and ilioinguinal nerve. If we are giving lot of pressure from inside the tack, and these nerves can also be injured if our tack is penetrating into the muscles. But if, for example, if we are doing TEP or TAPP, then these are the nerves which can be injured. So one has to know the location of the femoral cutaneous and the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve of thigh, genital femoral nerve, lateral femoral nerve. So all these nerves anatomy should be known to the surgeon, and definitely that will give the best advantage. In the end, I will discuss slightly about the function of the anterior abdominal wall. There is no point in going into the details of it. All of us know that these, definitely the oblique muscles, the rectus abdominis, pyramidalis, so they help in flexing and flexing of the trunk and stabilizing the pelvis. And one should be very, very careful. For example, when we are doing the ETEP, when we are doing ETEP RS, and if we are going above the level of the falciform ligament, then one may go into the diaphragm and cause the injury with the help of our harmonic or the monopolar. So one has to be very, very careful that we identify the planes there very well. And if we are able to identify the place, well, then only we can make a difference. Otherwise, that can become a challenging issue. So, in the end, I would say that you don't have to see the whole staircase. Just take the first step. And the first step is that it is the anatomy. One should know the anatomy well. And once you know your anatomy well, then only one can build that.